In this video, I want to take a look at the notion of average rate of change. Really, calculus as a whole primarily is concerned with rates of change, but there's two different types of rates of change. There's this kind, an average rate of change, which primarily uses algebra, and another type of rate of change called an instantaneous rate of change that we'll talk about in a little bit that uses more calculus. But let's begin with an average rate of change. Let's say you've got a function like this that goes from one point to another. This could be production level, this could be velocity, this could be distance traveled, it could be anything, temperature of the day, whatever. So it's going up and it's going down and going up and going down, etc. Sometimes it's increasing, sometimes it's decreasing. So sometimes the rate of change is positive, and then sometimes negative and positive and negative, etc. But over this given interval here from x1 to x2, it does have an average rate of change. Now, how do we see that? Well, really, it just deals with the first point and the last point. Matter of fact, if I just kind of did dotted lines between these two guys, if we found the slope between those two points, that would give you a sense of the average rate of change throughout the entire interval there. So like I said earlier, this doesn't use calculus, this is just algebra. What would be the slope between these two points? Well, rise, right? Rise over run, as we know from our algebra classes. So what's the vertical distance between these two? Well, we take y2 minus y1, that difference there, that's the vertical change, divided by x2 minus x1, and that would be your horizontal change. So that would give you the average rate of change over the entire interval. It could be miles per hour, feet per second, dollars per month. I mean, it could be anything really, but this right here is our average rate of change. All right, let's look at an example here real quick. Here we're given a function h of t equals negative 16 t squared plus 555. This is the height of the Washington Monument in Washington, D.C. And given a time, if we were to drop a penny off of the top of the Washington Monument, it would tell us what the height of the penny is. And so you notice that time zero has a height of 555 feet off the ground. And then 1 second later, as it starts to fall, you start subtracting some height away from that 555, and it goes down until it hits the ground. So this is the height dependent on the time that has fallen. So here's some typical questions you can expect to see with a question like this. First of all, it's totally not a calculus question. How long until the coin reaches the ground? How long until it hits the ground? Well, this doesn't require any calculus. This is just thinking about what this function says, and it would hit the ground when the height is equal to zero. So if we took negative 16 t squared plus 555 and set that equal to zero, that's like asking when did the coins have a height of zero? When did it hit the ground? So solve this for t, you'd have 555 equals 16 t squared. And so divide by 16 and then take the square root, t would equal the square root of 555 divided by 16, and that'll be some decimal value. So I'll find that out real quick here. Okay, let's see, we have square root of 555 divided by 16, 5.89 seconds approximately. So neglecting wind resistance, this would take almost 6 seconds for this coin to hit the ground. That's a very typical question. Now after that, then they'll start asking you some other questions. This deals with average rate of change. What was the average velocity during the fall? Now, velocity we know would be like feet per second, but that's exactly what our slope would give us. If this is the height in feet and the time in seconds, then rise over run would be feet per second. That would be your average velocity. So I need to find this average rate of change here. So I think this answer right here, this average velocity, would be the height at whenever it hits the ground, that's the terminal point, that's when it stops falling, at 5.89 seconds minus the initial height at 0 seconds divided by 5.89 minus 0. And if you notice, in effect, what we've done here is we've taken y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. That's all we've done. Change in height over the change in time. Now we just need to evaluate each of these quantities here. The height at 5.89, that's when it hits the ground. That was obviously 0. The height at 0 was 555 feet off the ground. And 5.89 minus 0 is obviously 5.89. So pull out our calculator here real quick. We'd have 555 divided by 5.89, and I'll change the sign of my answer here since I didn't put a negative in here. That's negative 94.23 feet per second. So every second is decreasing on average about negative 94 feet every second. Now, is it a consistent 94 feet drop the first second and the second and the third and the fourth and the fifth second? I don't think so. And we kind of know this intuitively as well. As soon as, you know, this little guy up here, as soon as he drops the coin, it's not going to be going very fast because gravity accelerates a coin and makes it go faster the longer that it's falling. So I'll bet, and you can do this at your paper, at your home there, if you found the average velocity in just the first second, I bet it would be much, much lower than negative 94 feet per second. It might only be, you know, negative 50 or negative 40 feet per second starting off, and then it speeds up. And then I'm sure during the last second, it's probably moving faster than 94 feet per second. So this is just an average, right? Matter of fact, that's what we're going to do for the third question here. What's the average velocity during just the last second? Well, let's see if we can do that here. So the last second, if it ends or hits the ground at 5.89 seconds or after 5.89 seconds, then 1 second before that would be 4.89 seconds. So I'd want to find the height at 5.89 seconds minus the height at 4.89 seconds divided by 5.89 minus 4.89. Now the easy part is this numerator is obviously 1, and I know the height at 5.89 seconds is on the ground, so really I have to find the height at 4.89 seconds. So for that I'll go to my TI, and I'll ask what's the height at 4.89 seconds. It tells me it's about 172.41. So we see negative 172.41 feet per second. Wow, that's moving very, very fast during that last second right before impact because it speeds up, you know, throughout the fall. So those are some typical questions you can see in regards to average velocity or average rate of change of a function. Now, let's close this video out with this short little topic here. We need to talk about the difference between an average rate of change and an instantaneous rate of change. Now, this topic won't make much sense until you watch my videos on derivatives. So if you haven't watched those yet, you probably need to watch those to have this one make sense. But even if not, you can probably gather a little bit from it. Okay, average rate of change, we've already talked about that. And to put this in context, let's use an example like we're traveling in a car and we get in our car and we speed up and we're going down the road and our distance increases as we leave our home or our starting point as time goes on. So we can speed up or slow down or speed up or slow down. And from initial to terminal point, there is an average rate of change. There's an average miles per hour. But sometimes we move faster, sometimes we move slower. Now the difference would be an average rate of change requires a beginning point and an ending point. And if you don't have both, average rate of change doesn't make sense. It assumes that you have a starting point and an ending point. Now on the other hand, an instantaneous rate of change is if you're in your car and you know, if someone were to call you and say, "What does your speedometer say right now?" and you took a peek at your speedometer and you told them instantaneously you're going 55 miles per hour. That's instantaneously. It's at that specific moment. So on a graph, you can see here just one point being defined. A slope would be of a tangent line to the curve, not between a starting point and an ending point. Now, the way that you would get this would be through using derivatives. And like I said, if you don't know what that is yet, that's okay. You can watch those videos first. But this would be derived from taking the derivative of the function and plugging in whatever the specific time is right here. And that would give you the instantaneous rate of change. So hopefully that makes average rate of change a little bit more clear. And like I said earlier, if you haven't watched the videos on derivatives yet, watch those and then you'll better understand instantaneous rate of change.